I do anything, I want to just check YouTube and see if this is working. But I guess while we wait here, I'll give an intro to Antonio. Oh, there we go. It's working. Okay. So Antonio is an Android developer. He is a Kotlin expert, and I'm saying expert because he has a certified course by JetBrains and also recommended by Google, his course about Kotlin and Android development. He is a speaker. He's an author. He's a blogger. He's a YouTuber. And apparently now he does podcasts. Thank you for being a guest on my podcast.
Thank you for having me.
Yeah.
It's nice to be here.
You know what's really surprising? You have a pretty big, I guess, online presence. And I've never heard of you before. But in the last couple hours, I kind of started looking at all your stuff. And I thought, how the hell did I not know that this guy existed?
Yeah, things happen. The same happened to me. I only know you for 1 month or two. Mm-hmm. And you have also a pretty solid audience. So these things happen, I guess.
Yeah, so we're both meeting each other for the first time pretty much here. So this is going to be good. So so I want you to start by telling me how you started programming. What like right from back in the day, 10-year-old Antonio. take me back.
Okay, so my story with programming is not as fun as others because I just didn't know what to do when I finished the regular studies. So I had to decide for a degree to do. And for some reason, computers was something that I liked, but I didn't have like much knowledge about them. I hadn't done almost anything related to coding. So I just did this degree because I wasn't very sure what to do with my life at that point. And it turned out to go very well because in the end I enjoyed it a lot and I did a career from it. But at the very beginning, I wasn't really sure that it was going to be my thing.
So undergrad is when you started programming? University or college was when you started?
Yeah.
Wow. Yeah. So that's it's kind of a late start considering you've seemed to have done quite a bit. By now at this point anyway. I checked out your LinkedIn and you have at least what, five or six years of experience as an employed Android developer?
I've been as an Android developer, like 6 or 7, and as a software developer, like 11 or so.
Oh wow, okay. So tell us about your first job in Android development. How did you get it, first of all, and how was it? Can you tell us any details about it?
Sure. So I started. Well, all my career has been done here in Spain, and I started in a consultancy company that is pretty big here in Spain, and it was because they were looking for people and it's like they are working together with the university, so when people finish their degree, they can start doing their career in this kind of company. So I did I tried to get into several companies and this one was the one that finally gave me that opportunity.
So what kind of things, sorry to interrupt you, what kind of things did you do to get your foot in the door, or like how did you go about getting these interviews? What kind of things were on your application? What kind of projects had you worked on? Really specifically, because I know a lot of people here watching, a lot of people who watch my stuff are either trying to get jobs or they're in college or they're in university and they're going to be trying to get jobs soon. So they want to know what kind of things they can do practically speaking to increase their chance of getting an interview or being looked at by companies.
For this particular first job, I didn't do anything special because we just had like this opportunity from the university to be available for several companies to do interviews, and they were looking just for for just graduated people. So it was kind of easy to find a job in that way.
Okay.
There, so, there are not so many developers here in Spain, and okay. the need was high at that point.
Okay, so like an internship sort of thing.
Yeah, cool. Kind of that.
Yeah, that's sorry, go ahead.
Yeah, I was going to mention that at that point I didn't start working as an Android developer. I think that story will be more interesting to your audience. Here I was just working with .NET products, in particular Microsoft Dynamics CRM, which is a platform for companies to have in one single place all the relationship with their customers, and we could customize that in several different ways, and that was my beginning as a developer.
Okay, so it's a one-stop shop for clients. They interpret your needs and provide a solution.
The solution is to keep all the information that companies have for their clients, like all the contracts, all the communication with them and all that. And then it could be customized for the specific needs of every customer. So
right,
we went to the companies and do the consulting to understand what they needed and then implement it customize this solution for them.
So you mentioned .NET. Was this the .NET job, or was this when you began doing Android development?
No, here it was all in .NET C# is what we used to customize that platform.
Okay. So then when did you start Android? How did you get into that ecosystem?
Yeah, so I got to a point that I was very happy with what I was doing, because in the end this platform was only used by one or two people in companies, but nobody outside that could use it. So it looked like a lot of work for not having hardly any users, and it was everything very corporative. So it was not the kind of job that I envisioned when I finished my degree. So I started trying different things like web development, and also at some point I could buy an Android phone and started trying things. And from the very first moment, I had this love relationship with Android development, and I couldn't stop from that point. That was
So you loved it right away? You never had any sort of struggles with it?
Well, the Android framework, as many of you may know already, is quite complex at the very beginning, but I took it like a challenge, and I never was like a pain to me, because as I was doing it on my free time, it was like a side fun job to me. So
yeah, it's really fun. Yeah, it's definitely difficult. None of us are strangers to that. There's a lot of things, but I have to say that it's at least in my opinion, it's improved significantly in the last. Like I've only been doing it for 3 years, maybe 3.5, something like that. And even just in that time, I've seen like significant improvements in the way things are done, the documentation, just lots of improvements for sure.
The tools, because when I started, we still use Eclipse for that. So Eclipse. So now with Android Studio, everything is much easier, and the IDE helps a lot. And also, as you mentioned, all the libraries, all the tools are much more powerful nowadays than in those days.
Mm-hmm. So now, you ended up how long? And you worked at a couple different companies. One was, I think, for 5 years, and one was for 1 or 2 years. What kind of projects were you working on at these companies?
I think that it's interesting also how I managed to find my first entry job. So that here is where I can give some advice to the audience on how to find a a job when you are going to switch your day-to-day work, or when you are starting. And what it really helped me, it was to start writing articles and sharing with the community, because at that point is when I started creating a personal brand that then helped me a lot in my interviews. Because in the company where I first started working as an Android developer, the people that were interviewing me had used my articles to solve their problems. So When you go to an interview in that situation, you have everything on your side to
huge advantage.
Succeed, yeah. So I always recommend that for people that are starting, don't be afraid to start teaching what you learn, because it doesn't matter that there are many articles and videos out there. There will always be people that are reading you and are being helped by you, and this is always a very huge, it's very helpful when you are trying to find a new job.
That is great advice. That's I think there's almost nothing better or more you could do to improve your chance of getting a job, for sure. Like you said, you had people at the place that you applied to using your articles. That's like the ideal situation.
Yeah.
You know, like they know you, they've used your stuff, they know it's good. You really can't beat that. You're definitely going to make the short list on the interview, that's for sure.
Yeah. So yeah, I always recommend to build up your personal brand in any ways. If you prefer doing videos, do videos. If you prefer going to events and give talks, that's obviously of a huge help too. So everyone needs to find their way to do it, but I always recommend that. It's not the only path, but in my way, it's the path that helped me a lot.
So you kind of do it all. You do video, you do online courses, you do articles, you do podcasts now. Did you ever think when you started that you'd be doing all of these things? Or
no, and the thing that I thought that I would never do is to do a talk in an event, because public speaking is one of my biggest fears, and I had to prepare a lot to mentalize of doing it and start doing it. But once you start, it's like a drug, you cannot stop.
like it's addicting, you mean?
Yeah.
Cool.
I think so.
So these jobs, once you got the job, what kind of stuff were you working on? Like what kind of apps? What kind? Tell me anything you want about your jobs.
So yeah, in this first job, I was like 1 year, and we did apps for other companies. So I worked for companies like Coca-Cola. It was an app that they were building for the Spanish public, and also another about cooking recipes, another one about, we did like a chat similar to Telegram or WhatsApp, and I also participating in another one that has like lot of popular chains of restaurants here in Spain. Like they have the franchise of Starbucks or Foster's Hollywood, and it was pretty interesting because I could try many different types of projects in a short period of time.
That's cool. So the company was it sounds like they were a contracting company. Did they work? they would just work with whatever clients, and then you guys would do whatever the client needed.
Yeah, exactly that.
So what's the employees there? What kind of team sizes did you work on, and what sort of, I guess, internal structures did you have to do these projects? Like you coming on as a new guy, how many seniors did you have, and how did they structure and organize the app development?
the fun thing is that I myself started as a senior.
Oh.
Even if it was my first Android position, they relied a lot on me. And very soon I started leading a team for this messaging app that I mentioned. And there we were like four people, I think. And four people for the Android app and other three or four for the iOS app. And the full Android team was like 7 or 8 people. It was not a very big company.
Cool. So you were hired as a senior right away. That's great. That's gotta be nice. I always say that you should almost avoid junior jobs, because if you get hired as a junior, you're probably going to be doing the things that not the seniors are doing, but the guys who don't have that junior title. You're going to be doing the same things. The junior title you can get stuck with, and it just means you're going to get paid less, which could end up being a problem.
Yeah, I think so too. And yet, thanks to, again, my personal branding, I guess, because I didn't have any experience in Android development, I managed to get into that company as a senior engineer, and quite soon I started leading teams, which was a very interesting task.
Yeah, that's awesome. So this job you were at, you said for a year, around a year? So what came after that?
After that, I started working at Plex, which is a company that maybe some of you know, that it's they build a platform so that you can have all your multimedia content, and then you can play it on any screens, because they have clients for all types of devices. And I was part of the Android team, and I was there like 4 years, 4 years more or less.
So that was a single product you were working on?
Yeah. Yeah, I moved from doing different products to move to a product company, which was also an interesting change.
Yeah, what was the pros and the cons of going from a company where you got to work on lots of different stuff, as opposed to a company where you were working on one product all the time?
Yeah, the pros of working in many small different products is that you can recycle your code in a way. You start from scratch, so you can just start trying new architectures or moving to different libraries that are newer at that point, and it also gives you more experience in different fields. And on the other hand, the drawback of doing that is that usually those projects has a start and an end, and it's more difficult to relate to those projects. You don't feel them like they are yours in the same way that when you are working on the same product for several years.
Oh yeah, I really know what you mean.
Yeah. So on the other hand, working on a product, yeah, that part that you feel more like on one side more responsibility over that product, because it's like part of you. You are spending on it 8 hours per day for years, and also you probably are going to do more complex things. Plex is a huge product, and we did like many different kinds of weird things and complex things. So that's more challenging in that way. But on the other hand, it's also easier to start feeling that you are being less productive because you have to deal with very old code. For instance, when I left, I was working on a base code that had like 7 years. So obviously, not all that code can be perfect. And also, when you have to change something, everything is slower. The steps you have to do to release an app, because when you are working for an app for 3 months, you probably release it once and forget. Here you have continuous delivery, all the scale that this means. So So it's very different. I really recommend if you can try both worlds, because you get a very broad idea of how these different worlds work.
Yeah, I know what you mean. Definitely. Working on lots of different projects would be interesting, but you would never get that sense that like it's yours, you know, mm-hmm. like you described, where if you're working on something all the time, everything you do to it, you feel really, yeah, you feel like it's yours and you're developing it all the time. But then again, I also see the downside of that, which is you were probably working on code that was 3, 4, 5, 6 years old, some of it. So yeah, there's a lot of inadequacies, inefficiencies, things like that.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And learning to deal with that, it's another good part of it, that we cannot always think that all the code we are working with is perfect. So having to deal with that, it also makes you grow as a developer.
Mm-hmm. So why did you end up leaving that job?
Why did
you end up leaving that job? It sounds like it was pretty good.
Yeah, in fact, it was a remote work. So even if the company is in the United States, we all could work from our country. So it was very good in many different ways. But for a couple of years, I had been also building up my own side project that started with the release of my book, Coding for Android Developers. Mm-hmm. I started writing it just because I felt like doing it. I've always had like this feeling of that I wanted to write a book, and it was really successful because it was the first book about coding for Android and about coding in general. So it became very popular, and at some point I had to take it like a secondary job. So this
book, you started writing it while you were working at your job, and then it what happened? You published it and it became so successful that you said it's time to quit the job?
No, I had to have these two jobs in parallel, because when you reach to an amount of money, you have to declare it in some way. And at least in Spain, it means that you have to work as a self-employee and also as an employee for a company. So you have like these two jobs at the same time with their own rules and their own fiscality. So at that point, I was like running two businesses at a time. One personal, another one that working as an employee for another company.
Okay.
So
how did you make money from your book? Is, I guess, a better, more direct question.
I did it because I self-published it, because otherwise, if you publish it using a publisher, it's probably not enough so that you can. So that you need to start dealing with this kind of problems, but there are not problems because they are producing you income, but you need to adequate to the rules of your country in that way. Mm-hmm. And thanks to self-publishing it, it started generating some income that then when also JetBrains started promoting it on their own reference page, and then when Google started supporting Kotlin, this growth exponentially. So
that was going to be my next question, actually. So because your course is certified by JetBrains, so obviously JetBrains endorses you and they support you, and also your course has been recommended by Google. So how did that happen? Because that's a pretty big deal. If you get endorsed by JetBrains for Kotlin and Google recommends your courses, like you're gonna get lots of people watching it.
So the idea of the course came after after Google announced Kotlin as a supported language in 2017. That I was doing this course also already for companies. It was in company training, and I decided to convert it to an online course so that everyone could do it. And the thing is that JetBrains at some point started created a partnership for trainers, and because they received a lot of requests for Kotlin training, but they didn't do that. They are in another business. So they decided to create this partnership program where they like test the trainer and also their trainings. And if they have the quality that they require for this partnership, then they give you the opportunity of using this logo that is the Kotlin training certified by JetBrains.
Oh, and, cool.
And that's how I started, because JetBrains helped me a lot also when I released the book, and they read it everything and gave me feedback, because it was the first book in the market. So we had like a close relationship already, and it was, in my case, obviously, it was not so difficult to reach to that partnership. But this partnership is open to everyone.
I see. Yeah. Okay, I didn't realize that. So all you would have to do is go and apply at JetBrains as a trainer, I guess, and then you get certified, and then they certify you as an online trainer.
Trainer in general. You can do also live training and whatever. In fact, I think that everyone apart from me are doing live training, and I'm the only one who has an online course at the moment.
That's cool. Wow. So you pretty much just own the market right now with your Kotlin for Android developers. That's great. And you're recommended by Google. That's awesome. You're probably making some good money off that. I'm jealous. I wish I would have thought.
At least enough to make it for a living. So when getting back to the question that why I quit my previous job, when our baby was born in last July, I had to make a decision because I didn't have enough time to continue with both things. And at that moment, I decided to try it on my own, because I know that if I didn't do it, I would regret for my
life. Yeah, that's the thing. That's the question you got to ask. Will I regret not doing this? That's mm-hmm. the question. That's the right question to ask.
Yeah, that's the question I usually do to myself when I have to decide something. I ask to myself, if I see myself in, I don't know, 40 years, what would I think of my decision of this decision that I'm doing now? Because otherwise we take decisions ruled by fears, and this is pretty common, because I had a very good salary and I have like a long career in my previous job. And if I move myself by my fears, I would probably have continued there as I have been for the past 4 years. But I thought about it and said, if I don't try it now, I probably won't have a better opportunity again. So let's go for it. And if it doesn't work, I always can go back to a company to work as an Android engineer.
Yeah, I think you made the right choice for sure. And especially because like your book was the first one, you've already been recognized by JetBrains, you've been recognized by Google. Like you're in a good spot. You essentially own the market right now. That's pretty awesome.
Yeah, there are many, nowadays there are many books out there, but yeah, it was the first one, so it's quite well positioned and a lot of Android developers know it. So it's still working good. Obviously, I'm not going to say the interest about Kotlin, but there are already many Android developers that already knows about Kotlin and have learned about it. So the market is becoming saturated in that yeah. way, and probably in the future I will need to go for another market or find other different products as I'm already doing. So that's not a problem. I think we must understand that this work changes a lot, and we need to recycle from time to time.
Yeah, that's the life of a software engineer, I think, is no matter what, like every I don't even know, 6 months at least, you have to learn something that is going to be uncomfortable no matter what.
Yeah.
Like, you might as well just accept fate. This is your life now. You have to learn stuff constantly. That's the way it is. That's the industry that you've gotten yourself into.
Yeah.
So you never did freelancing. You went straight from employed work to the online teaching.
No, I never did freelancing.
Okay.
Well, apart from very small things that I did on my own time a long time ago, but nothing remarkable.
Okay. So now I think I want to talk to the audience. I want to ask some questions from the audience. So all you guys who are watching, I didn't say hi, by the way, to everybody who said hi at the beginning of the stream. Hello. I'm seeing my regulars in here. Hello, everybody. Now's the time. If you guys have any questions, put them in the chat and we'll go through them. But in the meantime, I'll ask you a couple of things about the current state of Android development and kind of your opinions while we wait for questions to come in. So, so I saw recently, maybe it was recently. Anyway, I saw an article that you wrote about Coin and Dagger, and the title of it was "Is Dagger Dead?" or something along those lines. So, yeah. for those of these watchers who haven't read the article, I haven't read the article myself either. I kind of just glanced through it. What's that all about? What's is Coin? You think Coin is better than Dagger? Tell us about that.
Yeah, my point in that article is to rise a little bit the debate, because, well, I don't think we need to rush it too much, because it's something that is every time moving on Twitter. If you read it, everyone is talking about Coin versus Dagger and all that. But what I wanted to rise here in this particular video was that for those people that are really scared about starting with Dagger, because you and I and everyone knows that it's really difficult to learn and to understand.
Yeah.
A Coin can be a very good middle point to start, because it's very easy and you can forget about the library and simply understand the concepts of dependency inversion, dependency providing, and very easily start using something that is not as powerful as Dagger, but at least is powerful enough to do a lot of things. So, this was the thing that I tried to show in that video. Obviously, Dagger is not dead. It was like something to catch attention.
That's what I thought you were doing. That's what I thought you were doing, but I wanted to ask you about it just to see. I think that's a good strategy. You got to clickbait him sometimes.
Because I know there's a lot of polarization in this topic, and every time you talk about something about this, everyone got a very
emotional.
Yeah, emotional about one way or the other. So yeah, what I wanted to show here is that Coin is another alternative, and that I think is very good for starters if you think that Dagger is too much for you, and also even in small projects that we would consider adding Dagger because maybe it's too much for a small project. Using Coin is so cheap and so fast that it can be very useful for those projects. And I really would consider it in some situations.
Yeah. So I've never used Coin personally, but obviously I've used Dagger. I use Dagger. And I think if you look at all the things that I've learned in Android development, from everything, from fragments to activities, making network requests, handling cache data, you know, list all of the topics, whatever. Dagger was by far the hardest to learn, like by far. It's I don't know why, maybe because the code generators, it's not intuitive at all. Once you get it, it's like, oh, okay, yeah, it's fine. It's the same every single time, no big deal. You just do your little setup procedure and it's fine. But learning it was definitely difficult.
Yeah, and I think the other problem is that to understand how to use Dagger or dependency injection in general, you need to have some concepts very clear and very, you need to have understood all those concepts very well so that everything clicks on your mind when you start using Dagger, because it's a difficult tool and added to add with very difficult concepts that you need to understand first. So for people that start with Dagger without having learned those other concepts, it's really, really hard to start using it.
Yeah. So I see some questions here. So let's take a look here. The first one looks like, hi, Antonio, is it a paid course? Or it's a paid course, why not free? What do you have to say about that?
Because I'm living out of it. I need to pay my bills. So yeah. I have a lot of free content, a lot of free articles, and also a free training that we'll mention here at the end. So if you want to start with Kotlin, I have already a lot of free content. But when you want to do a certificated course, you need to pay for it, obviously.
And by the way, there is a link in the description of this video to go to his course if you want to check that out. I think there's a discount on it too, isn't there, right now? There's some kind of a discount?
If you go through the training, the free training that we can link it later, there's a discount here and a few extras. So I recommend you to see first the free training, and if that's enough for you, it's okay. And if not, you have a discount there that you can use.
So yes, you guys can learn it for free. Like it's always possible to learn things for free. But generally speaking, when you go to paid content, you're going to get better quality. The author spends more time on it because he's making money off of it. So I mean, if you can't afford it, don't buy it. I'm not saying buy it, but if you want to learn Kotlin a good way, the right way, and you want to learn it effectively and efficiently, don't be afraid to pay for resources. I personally pay for stuff all the time. I don't even think about it anymore, because when you compare these kind of things with university or college educations, it's like 1% of the cost. It's insane. And the amount that you learn is usually much better, or the things that you learn, the way that you learn is usually much better. So that's what I have to say about that anyway. And I am not going to be doing any Kotlin beginner stuff. Probably I like to build projects. So if you're watching my stuff and you're a fan of me and you want to learn Kotlin from me, I'm probably not the best person to like as in terms of a beginner, because I like to just build projects. So if you want a beginner course, Antonio's your guy.
Yeah, and adding to that, I must say that I also spend a lot of money in learning, because I from my experience, it reduces a lot the amount of time that you need to spend to reach to the same place. And yeah. I personally spend like, I don't know, 10% of my budget to keep learning things and keep building up on different aspects, because now that I have my own project, I cannot only learn about coding, I need to learn about many other things. But in general, I think that paying for courses and for learning, it's very profitable in the long term.
Yeah, and of course we're biased because we are two people who sell online content. So, you know, there's a very obvious bias there, but you know, just from one human to another, I spend tons of money learning myself. So, but again, the choice is always yours. So let's go to, so by the way, everybody, we're using a new streaming software. I don't know if you noticed, but up in the top right-hand corner, that corner over there, it says powered by StreamYard. I don't know if you guys can see that. I usually use Google Hangouts for these interviews, but they've, I guess, deprecated it or got rid of it. Sometime recently, they didn't tell me. So I went to go do this live stream and suddenly there's no Google Hangouts. So I was panicking. Anyway, we're using this software, and they have some features, and I'd like to, apparently if I click this, oh, look at that. Can you guys see that? There's a comment on the screen.
Oh,
that's cool. So I'm just kind of experimenting with these new features. Hello. EVM, hey, EVM. Florian coming in here to try and steal my subscribers as always. No, he's shameless. He's completely shameless.
He doesn't try to hide it, no.
No, he comes into my live streams. He says, "Hey guys," for like 2 seconds. So he walks, look, couple comments down. Okay, see ya. He just wants people to come in here and click on him and go check him out. He has no shame, this Florian guy. And he hides his identity. I don't trust him. I don't know. Okay, so let's go to the next question here. So I don't know how to say your name. Mujtaba? I'm sure I butchered it, so I'm sorry. I like your picture, by the way, the Android against the Apple. That's cool. Coding and flow. Mitch is better than you at Android teaching. Is that true? I'll let the audience figure that one out. I don't know. You guys can... It'd be cool if there was like a voting thing you could use with the software. This is cool. Okay. So let's go. Here we go. So Mercy Sparks. Nice picture also. Looks like a cat with glasses on. What's the best choice to make between Java and Kotlin for Android developing in the future? Antonio, what do you think?
My opinion is that nowadays it's almost impossible to ignore Kotlin, because you last Google I/O they announced that Android is going to be Kotlin first, which means that some other libraries are going to be released with support for Kotlin first. Some others even won't be available in Java, like the Jetpack Compose, for instance. So they are putting all their efforts on Kotlin now. And in my opinion is that it would be a little risky not to try at least then some Kotlin, because at some point in your current company or in the next one, you're going to need it, and it's going to be a problem not knowing about it.
Yeah. That being said, there's still a ton of jobs in Java. I think Java is one of the top five most used languages in the industry. So not in Android development alone, just like in industry. If you're a software engineer, there's a lot of Java jobs. So there are jobs, but you know, I've personally talked to guys who were working in the industry or are working in the industry as Java developers, and a lot of them are moving to Kotlin too. They say that it does everything Java does, but more, which is true. It's true with Android development, and it's true just with Java in general. So I think moving forward, like you said, Java is going to be, or Kotlin's going to be the way.
And especially in Android development, you would focus just on that and you want to grow your career as an Android developer, I wouldn't think about it.
Yeah. I share that opinion. I don't think, I personally think right now it's a good idea to know both. If you're a beginner, I think knowing Java before going to Kotlin is probably the better way to go. Like Kotlin's very easy to learn if you know Java. It's especially with Android, because all of the architectures are the same. The way you structure your code is going to be the same. It's just when you move to Kotlin, now you're going to have a bunch of conveniences. The things that were hard in Java will be easier in Kotlin. But going from Kotlin to Java, I think that would be very difficult. Very, very difficult.
Yeah, I had to do that for some time. That my own projects, I did it on Kotlin, and then when I got back to work, I had to do it in Java, and it was really painful.
Yeah, I think about it sometimes, because I would get these questions from people: should I learn Java? Should I learn Kotlin? And I think, would it be easier to go? Which way would it be easier? And I think going from Kotlin to Java would be so painful, so painful, because Java, it would be like going backwards in time, and all of these. Yeah, it would be bad. Don't do that. I don't recommend it. Anyway, let's go to the next question. Benny, that's a great picture. Benny, you're a good looking guy. Look at that clean haircut. Holy, everybody's got great pictures. What would be a good platform for your own articles? Start your own blog on your own webpage, or are there some platforms like Medium? So he's saying, what platform do you recommend to write articles on?
I've been using WordPress for my latest 6 years, and it works for me, so I wouldn't change it. I think you have the full control of it, especially if it's a self-hosted WordPress installation. And and that helps you grow in any ways you want. Because imagine that I had done everything in Medium during my previous years. Now that I would have to build up my community again around my own page and leave them there so that they can see my product, they can see my articles, and it's really difficult. When you depend on another platform, things become very risky because you put all your power on that company instead of on your own things. So
yeah, it's you're at risk, I think, no matter what, you know. Like, it's like people always ask me, what do you think about Firebase, and what do you as opposed to using like traditional methods, like putting up your own server and interacting with that. And it's the same question, really. It's like, mm-hmm. Firebase is great. It's convenient, easy to use. The tools are awesome. But if you use it to store data and suddenly, like, you have no control, you don't own the data. If something changes, they're probably not going anywhere. Like, I'm not saying that Firebase is going to, you know, disappear tomorrow, but it's, you don't own the data. If they decide to cut the cord, all of your apps that are running Firebase are see you later. Also, the data is very difficult to get off of the Firebase servers. It's not easy. So migrating would not be an easy task.
Yeah, so I always recommend have your own platform, which is much easier for everything.
But posting on like Medium and things like that, you should do also, I think. Like, you should probably do both. If you're going to write articles, post it on your blog, post it on Medium too, and then maybe put a link to your blog.
Yeah, of course, that always helps too.
So the next question here is from Amar. It says, okay, so the English is messed up, but I think what he's trying to say is there's Kotlin, there's Dart, there's Flutter. I'm confused. What is happening here? What are all of these languages? Help me. do you want to try and answer that one?
Yeah, I'm asked many times indeed if we should go for Kotlin or for Dart and Flutter, and my opinion is that nowadays Kotlin is clear that it's being used in the Android industry and that is working and that is going forward. So you have you can be sure that what you are learning, you are going to use it in the following months if you're not using it already. But with Dart and Flutter, everything is open, because many people ask me, because of the Fuchsia operating system that is supposed to use Dart and Flutter as the way to build the apps. But again, Fuchsia is another experimental project for Google, and they could close it tomorrow or it could go forward and finally substitute Android. Nobody knows, but this is Abed. And the same, it was Abed when I started with Kotlin. It could have been never be used, but if you ask me today, I would go definitely for Kotlin, and if you have time, of course, also learn Flutter and Dart, because they can be useful, but they are something that may not work in the future.
So I have something interesting to say about this. If any of you watched my interview with Vasily, I think his last name is Zukanov. It's a Coding with Mitch podcast. Did you watch that one?
Only some parts, didn't watch it entirely.
So one part of it, he was telling me we started talking, and he told me his conspiracy theory about Flutter. But I think it's actually pretty good. So Google's been in this ongoing lawsuit with Oracle about Java-related things, because obviously Oracle owns Java. And so it's always costing them money, and there's always problems and things like that. So his theory is that with Flutter and Dart and Fuchsia, their operating system, it's like Google's backup plan. If they encounter some kind of an issue, some kind of a lawsuit with a programming language, or you know, JetBrains decides, no, Google, you can't use Kotlin anymore, and Oracle decides, no, Google, you can't use Java anymore. And it's just going to cost way too much money for them to fight that. Then they have a backup plan. So, and that was basically his conspiracy theory in a nutshell. And I think that sounds reasonable. Like from a business perspective, that makes sense. It's like, it's at the end of the day, it's a backup plan. I don't know.
Could be an option.
Yeah. So anyway, but about Flutter, I think if you're a freelancer, Flutter is a great thing to learn because you can develop obviously both the iOS and the Android version. I've never used it myself, so I don't know, but people say that it's much easier to get an app up and running. So again, for freelancing, it's going to be easier. But in terms of the industry, it looks like Kotlin is where Google is telling their developers to go.
Yeah, that's my opinion too.
Yeah. All right, so let's take a look at the next one here. So it's the same question here that we just answered. So we shot two birds with, or killed two birds with one stone there. And let's go down. Okay. So Muj, I'm going to butcher your name again. Muj Taba. You should actually say in the chat how to pronounce this. Like break it up with dashes so that I know in the chat and I'll try and pronounce it. So there are things in Android development that do not make sense in the long run. For example, setting up a recycler view. I guess I see what you're saying. There's a lot of like things that you do every single time when you're setting up a recycler view. But yeah, I mean, I'm sure that will improve over time. There's a library called Groupy actually that you can take a look at that makes it a lot easier. I've been experimenting with that and it seems pretty cool. What do you think, Antonio?
Yeah, and talking about midterm, when they release Jetpack Compose, which is this library that that lets you build the UI in a more reactive way, in a similar way to, for instance, Flutter or React Native, the things will be very different to the way we do it nowadays. For instance, I recently listened to a podcast when they talked about it. Sorry, And for instance, the recycler view is not going to be as we know it nowadays. It's going to be just a component where you set a list of items and then specify how those items are going to be presented, but in a much simpler way, similar to what Flutter does, for instance, or React Native too, that they follow very similar approaches. So these things are changing. They know that building UI is not the best way nowadays and with XMLs and all these components. So they are changing it a lot with Jetpack Compose and hopefully we'll see it in the following years.
Yeah. So, I mean, it's a constant, everything's improving constantly in general, I think. And it's inevitable, you know, only a few years ago, recycler views were invented and there used to be list views, which were much, much worse than recycler views. So recycler views are actually still a pretty big improvement, and now that they work pretty good, it looks like they're looking at shortening the amount of time and the amount of code that it takes you to set them up, because chances are you're going to do the same things in every recycler view over and over again. You know, you give it a list of data, when you scroll there's going to be pagination, there'll be a little loading animation, there'll be an on-click listener, maybe be able to rearrange them. You know, it's the same kind of stuff over and over again, so I'm sure it will improve over time.
Yeah, definitely.
All right. So the next question, Nate says, "I'm digging the new streaming setup. Looks good." Thanks, Nate. Yeah, it's pretty cool. You know, I was nervous at first when I saw that they had gotten rid of Google Hangouts, but this software is pretty cool, and it looks like they have. I was kind of looking at all the options here as we're talking, and it looks like they have like a premium version you can buy, so I can replace that. Where is it? It'll be over there. That powered by StreamYard thing up in the top corner. Yeah, you can replace right there. Yeah, you can replace that with my logo, looks like. So that's cool. So I'll probably end up getting the premium as long as it's not like some crazy amount of money. So it looks pretty cool. Let's see here. In the beginning, I'm assuming this is for you, Antonio. In the beginning of the year, you made a post comparing MVP with MVVM. Do you still agree with the things you said about both on the part that you described some random thoughts about them? I'm assuming this is your post because I've never wrote a post on MVP. I have lots of stuff on MVVM, but nothing on MVP. So
it's mine. Yeah, I don't remember the exact points there. I remember that I said something like that if you are already using MVP and it's working for you, it doesn't make a lot of sense to migrate to MVVM. And I still consider that they both have their pros and cons, and one needs to decide. MVVM is more tied to the rest of the Jetpack library. So when you are using all those libraries, it becomes much easier to do certain different things with MVVM. And as opposed to that, when you use MVP, you can abstract totally from the Android framework. So this has their own pros that you, for instance, could be reusing in a very ideal world. You could be reusing those presenters in different platforms when you use, for instance, something like Kotlin multi-platform or things like that. So there are pros and cons for both approaches. And I still think that choosing one or the other are winner options, and you are not going to have many problems with any of them.
Yeah, I always say this. I don't think there's a best architecture. I think at the end of the day, whatever architecture fits your project best, whatever makes the most sense to you, is the one you should use. And like Antonio said, if you MVVM is more tightly tied to the new Jetpack features, you know, like you can return live data from room, lots of different stuff you can do with live data. And there's also retrofit libraries that help Jetpack. So there's lots of conveniences with MVVM, but well, I mean, whatever you like, whatever you prefer. So the next question is, what do you think about Rx Java when compared to coroutines?
The other big question.
Yeah. I mean, yeah, there's kind of two, well, there's three big-ish questions now. It's should I learn Kotlin or should I learn Java? What's the best architecture? And coroutines. Yeah. Like, should I use coroutines compared to Rx Java? Those are like the big three.
Yeah, so this one I've already talked about it several times too, and my opinion is that in the way that many people were using Rx Java before, which just was to move between threads, to move processes from the main thread to the background thread, I think that coroutines are much easier to use in that aspect. But the main goal of Rx Java is not just that. It's just to be able to implement reactive programming inside your projects. So this is a very different topic because the way you program changes a little. And in the state that coroutines are currently, if you are thinking about reactive programming, Rx Java is much more powerful nowadays. There's a thing to add here that the coroutines team is building a library that is called Flow, which main goal is to bring the features of the reactive programming and Rx Java to coroutines. So when we reach to that point, which currently is an alpha library, I think, when we reach to that point, we will need to rethink this answer, because maybe as coroutines are easier to understand, it's much easier to go for coroutines instead of Rx Java. But again, both libraries will be and both solutions will be perfect for most solutions. So if you are using already Rx, I wouldn't change it for coroutines unless you have a very clear reason to do it.
Yeah, I agree with pretty much everything you said. Like at the start, you said coroutines is easier, like in terms of asynchronous threading, you know, doing work on background, posting results to the main thread, you know, whatever. There's more things you can do with coroutines, and it's easier to set up and do for sure. But then when it comes to reactive programming, which all of us are doing reactive programming, basically, this observable observer thing, I mean, because at the end of the day with the coroutines, you're using, if you're doing any kind of database interaction, network interaction, you are returning this suspend function thing in coroutines, and it's not reactive. So you have to take the result and then post it to an observable. You have to do something. Whereas with, you're always going to be doing an extra step. Whereas with RxJava, you can return observables right from your network, right from your local database. So it's, if you're, it's going to be easier in that regard. But like that being said, there's ways around this. Like if you've looked at the architecture components, Google samples, which probably a lot of you have, they're really awesome. They have this class called the network bound resource, which basically it's a generic class where you have some transactions that you would want, that you would pass it, you know, load data. I keep missing the camera here. Load data from a cache, load data from network, whatever, set it to live data and then return the live data. So I've been experimenting with coroutines in a class like that, where you can build this class that returns live data, and inside the class you can fire up coroutines. So you can do main thread stuff, background thread stuff. So I mean, and it sounds like they're building, like you said, they're building a library that will eventually handle all of that kind of stuff for you. So moving forward, coroutines will I think inevitably be the way to go. Probably.
Yeah, I think so. And yeah, with this flow library that the coroutines team are building, I think that the main goal with that library is exactly to be able to do everything you do with RxJava, be able to do it with coroutines. So
yeah.
So at that point, probably there will be RxJava defenders because they prefer the API for some reason, and it's perfectly understandable. But yeah, coroutines will have the same power with this extra library.
Yeah. So at the end of the day, you'll probably run into the same situation that you have with Java and Kotlin, where it's like, okay, do I learn Java or do I learn Kotlin? Kotlin can do everything Java can do and more. The same thing will happen with coroutines in RxJava. It'll be like, you'll have coroutines, you'll have RxJava. RxJava or coroutines will be able to do everything RxJava can do and more. That's the situation that it will inevitably end up in, I think.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think so too.
Next question. How many experience should one spend in Android development, in your opinion? That's kind of a vague question. I'm not really sure. It's not like there's no like, how much experience do I need to apply to a job? How much experience do I need to start freelancing? I'm going to skip this question because it's vague. Mm-hmm. And we're going to go on to the next one. So I've seen this a couple times. What is architect coders? I don't know. I saw this question a couple times in the chat. It mm-hmm. might have been asked by the same guy. I don't know. It's a couple different people actually. So do you know what that is? I don't know.
Yeah, it's here in my t-shirt.
Oh, I didn't even notice.
So yeah, this is a new program that I'm building that it's more focused to good quality code. So it's like the step forward. Once you learn Kotlin, how to start building quality apps, and it's based on things like solid principles and architectures. Presentation patterns, testing, etc. So it will be a bigger program because it's a three-month one where all the people will be working together to learn those things and work together to create apps. But this is something that I'm preparing to be released very soon in Spanish, but in English it will take a little longer, maybe by the end of the year or something like that. So that's why I'm still not talking too much about it, but I'm leaving some things around so that people start talking about it and asking about it.
That's why I got the shirt on.
For the future.
So, okay. Zany. Last week I was learning about navigation component. Do you think it's a good approach to use these principles when developing apps? Do you have much experience with navigation components?
I started with it just very recently. In fact, I watched your video. It was a lot of help to understand everything. And I think that it's very useful, but also understanding that it has its own limits. But from my experience, I have read a lot of comments about it, and I was a little reluctant to start using it. But after using it a little bit, I think it's pretty interesting and quite powerful for the regular cases of navigation in an Android app.
Yeah, regular cases is a key word here. Because I've been using it quite a bit. Like, I've been experimenting with it quite a bit. I'm using it in my newest upcoming course, the Open API Android application that interacts with a REST API that I built on a server. And I've been experimenting with it. So the app that I build in it has a bottom navigation bar. And if you don't use like a bottom nav, a nav drawer, any kind of a navigation system, the navigation components works really well. Like, it's solid. I love the diagrams. I love the way they navigate. I love everything. It's great. But when you start using a navigation controller, or sorry, a navigation bar or a navigation view of any kind, because you start dealing with different navigation graphs. So for those of you who have experience, you know that navigation components uses this thing called navigation graphs, which is basically the flow of between the fragments. So when you have different navigation graphs, like you would have on a bottom navigation drawer, like if you had three different entries on the navigation drawer, you would have three different navigation graphs that would all have their own backstacks. So the backstacks are independent. So this kind of behavior is not really supported by navigation components yet. Like in their sample, it shows you kind of how to do it. And I figured out how to work around it, but the workaround is not really simple, which I'll be showing you in my newest upcoming course. I think moving forward, like in a year, it's probably going to be really, really awesome. They'll probably have figured out all of these little things, like tying it into the bottom navigation view, tying it into a navigation drawer, how to handle all that stuff. But right now it seems immature, I guess I would say, but I'm still going to use it. I still think it's awesome. But it will require some finagling, I guess. So that's what I would say. So for backend in Android, which database should I learn?
For backend in Android, if you mean how to build your database inside your Android app. Nowadays, I would probably go for Room, unless you have some very specific needs.
I think he means network database.
Network.
Yeah. So the data that's stored for your app, your apps, your users' data. What do you think about the best database to use?
I don't have a lot of knowledge about that point specifically.
Okay.
I would probably go for Firebase for simple cases and then build your own one. But I think that Mitch has a lot more context in that because he's creating some articles about it. So
yeah, I don't have a lot of experience with lots of different types of databases, but Postgres and any SQL database, I would say. Because that, like, at the end of the day, then you have control. Firebase is great, but you don't own the data. That's the problem. So if anything happens, if any magical scenario happens and you lose that data, you're screwed. So there's no, like, it's a very bad scenario to lose your user's data. Your app basically will flop. It's like game over. So, I think for beginners, if you're just building little projects, you're playing around, you're learning, Firebase is the way to go because it's easy. They have all these tools. They're great. But if you're a developer who's developing a product for a customer, probably an SQL database on a server. And I have courses on that too, and they're free. So I can show you how to put up a server, how to manage your database, how to do all this stuff. And then I'm also building a course on how to interact with that database. So there you go. Next question. This is actually, which backend should I use? Firebase, Node.js for developing a chatting app? Like, I basically just answered that. So if you're just doing a whatever little project, Firebase is probably the way to go. If it's a big app for like a customer where you know this is going to exist for a long period of time, I would put up the server because then you have complete control. Okay, Muhammad says, which is the best way to implement multiple screens layouts, constraint layout, or creating different layouts? What do you think, Antonio?
Multiple screens, I guess he refers to, for instance, phone versus a tablet or...
I would think he means like screen size, but I'm multiple screen. Yeah. Multiple screen. Oh, maybe not. It could be multiple. I don't know. It could be either one, like tablet versus a phone, where like, you know, tablet usually has like, they'll have like a, they have a different way that they lay it out, or maybe size. I don't know.
No idea, but it depends a lot. For instance, in the big apps that I worked before, for some screens, it was enough to have the same layout that resized properly. It doesn't need to be a constrained layout. It could be whatever layout that fits your needs. And then if there are many different positions of the items or even some components that appear in one screen and don't appear in the other, then going for specific layouts for those helps much more. But I'm not sure if this is what he was asking. So if he can give us more context.
Yeah, that would be great. Give us more information. I think he means different screen sizes, though. Next question. I want to know what you think of navigation components. They break the navigation principle of the bottom navigation bar. They don't provide any fragment, hide, and show options. Yeah, like I said, there's like I said earlier, there's limitations. I think it's just new. And I think I like the direction they're going with the graph, the navigation controller. I love that stuff. And it's very clear too. Like if you walked into a project and you had never seen that project before, you could very easily go and look at the navigation graph and you have a graph of everything. You know what fragment goes where, what, like, you know everything. So that's really cool. But like I said, I think it's immature at this point. There's a few hiccups. After 3 years experience with Kotlin and Java, what do you guys recommend for one's career to experience more in Kotlin Java for Android, or switch to other things like Swift, iOS, Flutter? So for the career, what do you think is better? Stick with Kotlin or go and check out some other stuff?
It depends a little on how you are focusing your career. If you want to sell yourself as an expert on something, I always recommend getting deeper into that, even if in your free time you spend some time to other platforms or other technologies. But if you prefer to go to a broader amount of technologies, and this will probably give you more opportunities but less remunerated, then you can learn about other different things. In my personal opinion, I would focus first on learning how to write quality code, in learning more about architectures, more about how to modularize your app, and these other things that are quite more cross-platform, to say it in a way, that you can, once you learn that, you can move to Swift or you can move to Flutter, and those same principles apply because are software development foundations, to say it in a way. And then if you have free time, I think it's good to continue with other things, but I would focus on that first.
Yeah, I'm a fan of get good at one thing, get like really good at one thing, and then maybe start dabbling in other things on the side. But like there is so much to know in Android development. It would be hard. It's hard for me to imagine that you're like, they're like, oh, I know it all. I'm ready to move to the next thing and get some more experience. I'm not saying it's a bad idea, but I think you're more employable and you probably get a higher salary if you were to just really focus on Android. That's what I would think. But whatever you think. By the way, Antonio, I didn't ask you. Do you have time to answer some more questions? Because I know we're getting over an hour now.
Yeah, it can be half an hour more or so.
Okay, so let's just go through these questions, and then I got a couple questions that I want to ask you, and we'll finish up.
Okay.
So let's see. Shahid, I think his name is, says using Android pagination library. So he says I'm assuming he means the paging library with network only, no local database. Why do they not give you functionality to notify and update a single item without reloading the entire recycler view list? Do you have experience with the paging library?
No. So hardly any.
So I also have hardly any, but I have hardly any for a reason, and I will share you that reason. I think it's very complicated. It's like, in my opinion, it's not the complexity and is not worth using it at this point. That's what I think. Because I set it up and I got it working, and then I don't know how long it took me, but it was not easy to do, and it didn't even do really what I wanted it to do. So, I mean, at this point, I would say building a custom pagination system is probably going to be easier. I actually show you how to do that in my MVVM and REST API course. So if you want to check that out, I show you how to do that. Just go to my website, codingwithmitch.com, or take a look at the code. Code's free. So yeah, I mean, that's what I would say. I think it's a good idea because, as we talked about earlier in this live stream, you know, things like recycler views are always the same. They do the same kind of thing over and over again. Pagination is always the same. You scroll to the bottom, it loads some more. You scroll to the bottom again, it loads some more. But right at this point, I think it's not ready. I would say it's too complicated at this point. I could just be dumb. I don't know. Somebody tell me I'm dumb. But I spend a lot of time learning Android things, and this does not seem easy to me. So it doesn't seem easy, and it doesn't seem worth it. So that's what I would say. So Kevin Matthew says, all the videos now Mitch streams makes a switch from Java to Kotlin. I'm a beginner, and now only I learned Java. Why are you doing this to me? Well, I'm sorry, but I only report what I see. And as I see it right now, Kotlin is the way to go. So unfortunately, you can blame Google for this, but Kotlin is a superior language, and it's just better. So I apologize. Yeah. I apologize, Kevin.
It's always very, very good to learn new languages. You see the same problems in a different point of view, and then even if you go back to the old language again, you will start doing things in a different way. So I think it's very powerful to learn a new language.
Yeah, for sure. Even like a completely different one, like going and learning Python or something like that, and just looking at how much easier it is to do certain things. Maybe it's more difficult to do other things. It gives you a good perspective. So Amit says, my university is going to conduct a Kotlin Everywhere event hosted by Google on September 13th. Can you suggest me some trick questions for developer advocates? So I think what he's asking is somebody's going to be presenting to his class, and he wants to ask questions that are very difficult. I don't know. How would you interpret that?
I'm not very sure. Because in Everywhere are those events that Google and JetBrains do together. They fund this event so that Kotlin arrives many different places. But I'm not sure if he wants to actually get some clever questions to the developer advocates or something like that. But
all right, we're skipping it. Next. Amir says, is it useful to going deep into data structures and algorithms for the Android field, or is it more related to back end, not front end? Well, Android technically has back end and front end, but I know what you're asking. It's should I go deep into data structures and algorithms if I'm going to be an Android developer? What do you think about this?
I think it's good to have a basic knowledge, but I wouldn't go very crazy with algorithms and all that, because at the moment that you have a performance problem at some point, you then can go and find ways to solve that specific problem, and Google is there always helping us. So I don't think we need to have all that information in our head.
Yeah, I that is exactly how I would answer that question. It's like, you could waste so much time learning these things. Unfortunately, all big companies too, they want you to know that deep knowledge of data mm-hmm. structures and algorithms. But practically speaking, it just doesn't come up. You don't run into these problems in Android development. And if you do happen to run into the problems, you can just Google for the answer. You'd say, I'm trying to do whatever, Google the symptom, look for an algorithm, look for a data structure you're going to be coming up with the data structure, but Google the algorithm, Google different algorithms, different sorting algorithms. And you could that would be a much more efficient way to solve that problem, I think. Mm-hmm. And I've talked to, like my interview with, Nathan Follestead. I think that was his name. Oh man, I forgot his name. I'm just checking my Instagram right now. Pretty sure it's Nathan. No. Aiden. It's Aiden. Aiden Follestead. I did an interview with him at CodingWithMitch podcast, and he's an Android developer. He's a full stack Android developer. And he said that it never comes up. Like deep knowledge of data structures and algorithms almost never comes up in his day-to-day. He's worked at Target, which is a very big company. He works at Square right now, which is a very big company. They developed Retrofit, I believe. They've developed lots of libraries that lots of developers use. It's a big company, is what I'm saying, and it never comes up.
And probably if you go to a company where they need it, let's imagine a maps company, they probably have mathematicians that are going to give you the perfect algorithm for that situation, and you only have to implement it. So it's difficult that you find in those situations. Yeah.
Yeah. So, I mean, it's up to you. Like I said, a lot of companies unfortunately want you to have that data structures and algorithms knowledge, but you probably won't run into it often in an Android job. So next question is Amit again. Do you think that MVVM can be improved further, like the case for multi-bindings? What else can be done to further to make the developer's life easier?
That's a difficult question.
Yeah, who knows? It's like he's asking, can you predict the future? That's sort of what it is.
I can't think of anything right now.
Yeah. So I do have an opinion on this, actually, but only because recently I've been working with MVI architecture. I've been exploring MVI, and basically MVI is MVVM with like some added things. So I mean, MVI would be what you want to go look into, because just to kind of put it in, explain it quickly in a nutshell, what MVI is. Imagine you have a view model class that has a whole bunch of mutable live data objects in it. You're observing them, whatever. What MVI is it packages all of those live data objects into a single object, so a single data structure, and then you observe that single live data object. So but there's other things too, but like in general, that's what it is. You package all of your view, the things that are going to be in your view, into a single data structure, and then you observe that data structure through live data. So it's like an MVVM improvement. I don't know what else you would call it other than an MVVM improvement, because that's really what it is. So MVI, take a look at MVI. Let's see. Suppose I'm displaying a count of likes of a post. How can I display it live, direct from a network? Got an answer?
You probably need kind of socket for that, where the server can inform you at any moment if something is changing, and then have an observable around that. But if the server is not providing that to you, you probably need to be polling the server several seconds or something like that to get the information otherwise.
Yeah. Or you could use Firebase. Firebase is a real-time database, so you can use that. But also, if you're using your own server, I actually know of something that you can use. It's called socket.io. I've never used it, but essentially, my understanding is you install this thing on your server, and you can get real-time updates from your database. And then, of course, like Antonio said, you observe it in your app and get real-time updates on your UI. Next question, Amar, which is the best way to implement push notification in a chat app?
Well, I haven't implemented push notification for a long time, but I guess that's probably Firebase is again the answer.
Well, they actually deprecated Google Cloud messaging, which is the way that push notifications used to be pushed out to clients in the past. Now they have something called Firebase Cloud Messaging. So you're forced to use Firebase these days. You have to use, it's called FCM, Firebase Cloud Messaging. So, you know, you could have a Firebase real-time database. You could use Firestore. When data gets inserted into your Firebase database or into Firestore, you could have a cloud function, a Firebase cloud function that will trigger the creation of a Firebase cloud message. That is the process. I have a course on it actually on Pluralsight. So just go to pluralsight.com. My course is just type in the search Firebase cloud functions, I think, or Firebase cloud messaging, and my course will come up and it shows you how to do that. I think I actually have a free, I have a blog post on it too, actually, on my website. So if you go to my website, codingwithmitch.com, go to the blog section and search Firebase or Firebase cloud messaging or something, and you'll find the blog post. It's outdated, but it should still work. Questions keep coming in. Let's see. Amit again. So many questions, Amit. Wow. So every activity or fragment will have one dedicated package which encloses all of the live data in MVI. No. So I obviously didn't explain that very well. It's so every activity or fragment will have one dedicated package. I misunderstood what you said. So I think what you're saying is by dedicated package, you mean dedicated data structure. So like a class, a data class that encloses all of the objects that you would be that all of the live data objects. Yes. But they're not live data objects. They're just regular objects. So imagine a registration screen, for example. You have an email field, a username field, a password, and a confirmed password field. Inside, if you were creating a view model for that screen, you would create a data structure named, registration fields. Call it registration fields. It would have four parameters: string email, string username, string password, string confirm password, and then you would observe that that registration field's data structure. So you're encapsulating all of the possible fields or the things that are going to be displayed in the view into a data structure, and then observing that single data structure. And then also there's that wouldn't be it. There would be another layer on top of that. So there'd be a wrapper for displaying your loading, your error, or your data coming from your cache or your API. I'm going to be talking about this soon. I'm going to be making videos on this because it sounds complicated, but it really makes a lot of sense when you actually do it. Did I ask you if you wanted to answer that, Antonio?
Yeah, sure.
Never mind. Okay, we're going to go to the next next question. Well, we kind of already answered that, the cross-platform question about Flutter. Here we go. Sundar says, how to seamlessly integrate repository pattern to sync local and remote database. Please let me know the functionality. Do you have you said you didn't have much experience working with remote databases, right, Antonio?
I have some experience, not a lot, but
do you wanna?
The thing is that in my case, I prefer not to rely on on exact implementations, and what I usually do is to have a repository pattern, as he mentioned, and then this repository has different data sources which are totally abstracted. One would be the local data source, and the other one the remote data source. And that way, you at some point can change the room for another library or the integration with the server with another one. And just with that, you can then the repository will deal with the logic related to whether they should go to the remote repository or the local database, etc. Not sure if that answers the question.
Yeah, but I mean, it's good information either way. How to seamlessly integrate repository pattern to sync local and remote database. Yeah, okay, so you want to know practically. I actually have a course exactly on this. So if you go to my website and search, go to courses and search for the local database caching course, that's exactly what I show you how to do. It's an app that interacts with a REST API. And when you make the request to the server, it caches the response and it views the cache as a result. So it follows something called the single source of truth principle, which means the observable that you're observing in your UI is always the same source. So it's always viewing the cache. What it does is you make a request, it starts viewing the cache. In the background, it updates the cache with the network data. Meanwhile, you're still viewing the cache. So and it uses the repository pattern, it uses MVVM. So I think that's exactly the question that you're asking. So I would go check that course out.
You have a course for everything.
Yeah, I got a lot of videos. I think like on YouTube, I got like 500 videos. On Pluralsight, I have 9 or 10 courses on Pluralsight. So that's like, I don't know how many videos that is. That's hundreds though. And then on my website, I have videos that aren't on YouTube. So there's hundreds there too. So like I got to have close to 1,000 videos. So if I haven't covered it, it must be brand new because I got a lot of stuff. Yeah. So there's a lot of questions here coming in still, but I don't want to keep Antonio for too long. So I want to kind of finish up here. So maybe I'll scan the questions and cherry pick at the end, but that's going to be probably it. And the last kind of questions I want to ask you, Antonio, is because you seem like a guy who works a lot, you do a lot of things, you speak, you make courses, you used to be employed, you do podcasts. Even when I booked this podcast, I had to go through booking software because he's such a busy guy and he didn't have a lot of free time slots, that's for sure. So the question I have for you is what do you do about work-life balance? How do you manage that? What kind of a work-life balance do you have? And what sort of things would you say about that?
My life work balance is pretty important to me since my baby was born. So now obviously I need to spend more time with my family. And what I do is that I have a pretty tight schedule that I rarely ever trespass or use any of these hours. That I always end up working until last week, because I changed it this week. I'll tell you about my changes. Until last week, I always worked until 6:30 p.m. And from that time on, I wouldn't do any work at all. But that was still a lot of time, because I start at 7 in the morning. So what I decided from this week onwards is to work 8 hours per day. And that means that usually, not today, but usually I would end up at 4:30, and then I have the rest of the afternoon and evening to be with my baby and my wife and spend that quality time with them. So that's why the calendar is so tight, not because I have so many things to do, but because I want to reduce the amount of time that I spend on my project just to have time to for my family.
Yeah, that makes sense. And for me, I actually did a live stream about this. I don't know, maybe a couple of days ago. So you can check my YouTube channel if you want to know my question about my answer about work-life balance and how I manage it. But basically, I schedule everything pretty tightly. And when I'm working, I'm only working. And I make sure to do a lot of other things. Like I spend time with my dogs, my wife, make sure to exercise lots. And I find that if you keep this balance, you end up getting a lot more done. Like if you spend too much time working, you're not effective. Like, yeah, I mean, yeah,
waste a lot of the time.
You waste a lot of time. And I'm, you know, obviously there's people out there who can just kind of push through. And my realtor's calling me. Okay, good thing we're finishing up here. So you waste a lot of time, and it's better to take breaks. And I used to think that it's always better to power through, but it's not. For some people, yes, but that's definitely the exception, not the rule. Like very few people can sit down and work for like 10 hours straight, or even like 5 hours straight. Like I usually do 3 hour blocks of time, but that's what I would say. So let's, next question is, these are kind of just the last questions I have for you before I let you go.
Okay.
What is your thoughts on university education versus online education for software development?
So I have kind of mixed feelings here. I must say that probably if I hadn't studied my degree, I wouldn't probably be here today, because I wasn't very sure of what I wanted to do. So probably would have ended in a very different situation. I wouldn't have been consistent enough to learn everything you need to learn to become a software developer. But if from the very beginning, since you are very young, you have very clear that you want to become a software developer and you are doing your own things, maybe it's not that difficult to skip that step and move directly to learn everything you need from online resources. So it really depends on the kind of person you are and your motivations, in my personal opinion, and it can be very different because we all have our own story. So I would love to hear yours, Mitch.
I think with software and programming, you definitely can learn everything you need to online and for like a fraction of the cost. Like university is very expensive.
It depends on the country, of course. Here is cheap in comparison.
Depends on the country, but like in the US and Canada, it's where I'm from is very, very expensive, like insanely expensive. Like some people don't pay off their student debts until they're like 60 years old. Like it's insane. So for me, like to me with programming in general, it's definitely learn yourself. Go learn online, because it'll cost about 1% of the cost. And you'll probably get a better education, because I think what's the problem? One of the problems with schools is there's so much new stuff coming out all the time. They can't get instructors in there fast enough with the new stuff. So you're always learning outdated things. Typically, you're learning outdated things, especially if you go to a university or a college that is more reasonably priced. So if you go to like the top best university in the country, you'll probably get a good education, but it will probably cost you like $400,000 US or Canadian. So then at that point you're like, okay, that I have a good education, but now I'm in debt. I could have bought a house. So I don't know. My opinion is learn online.
In that situation, I agree with you. It's totally different situation from here in Spain. It's pretty cheap to have a good public education.
Yeah, not the case for here. So, I would say learn online and just YouTube, my website, Antonio's courses, wherever. You're gonna get a great education. We keep up to date with all the newest things. You know, he's a certified trainer, so that's what I would say. So that's kind of all I wanted to ask you. I guess that kind of finishes up. The last thing I would just say is, Do you want to tell us about anything you got going on, to promote anything? Where can people stay in contact with you? Where can they get their course, your courses? Because I know lots of people are going to want it. And yeah.
Sure. So if you want to know anything about me, in antonioleiva.com, you have all the links for everything. And what I wanted to give to your audience is the chance to join to this free training about Kotlin, where it's a live video training where you can learn the basics of the language, and probably you can go on your own with that. And if not, you have that discount that we mentioned at the end of the video if you want to go further and learn with my course. So Mitch will probably update the description of this video so that you can go to that training instead of going directly to the course, which is a little more expensive, and you can take this offer, which will be more will be easier for you to start with it.
So for those of you who are looking to switch from Java to Kotlin, which inevitably all of you are going to have to switch from Java to Kotlin, this is only a matter of time. His course is for those of you who are just kind of tuning in, his course is a JetBrains certified Google recommended course. So you can go from knowing absolutely nothing about Kotlin to being a proficient Kotlin Android developer. So it's worth checking out. And like I said, all the links will be in the description of this video for everything that you need shortly. Anyway, within the next 5 minutes, I'll have it all updated. So thanks for coming on, Antonio.
Thank you for having me. It was a pleasure.
I had a good time. Your baby's crying. Looks like you looks like you got to go spend some time.
All the time. She's very noisy.
So I'll let you go. Thanks everybody for watching. Sorry I didn't get to any of your questions at the end here. We just don't have enough time. So thanks, and I'll see you all in the next one.
Thank you. Bye.
Bye-bye.